Morning, boss. This week's income from the sponsors has cleared, and we're making good profit against our running costs.
It has been a while since I've kept that little audio bit in at the very start of these videos, but what's up, guys? Aaron here, and welcome back to another episode of my F1 2020 My Team Career Mode, episode number 85 today for the Dutch Grand Prix in Season 5. If you guys did miss the previous one at the Bahrain Grand Prix, then be sure to go check that one out before you see this one. That was an absolutely nuts Grand Prix. The results were bonkers, but even the racing itself towards the end of it was really, really quite intense, and I'm sure you'll very much enjoy it if you did not see it already. But we come now to Zandvoort, which was, remember, one of the toughest Grand Prix last season for us, when we had that dog of a car that was bankrupt and had no aerodynamics. This circuit was very, very difficult, but we come to this circuit now, one season later. We've got one final upgrade to do, there it is, and we now have a fully maxed out car on the performance-wise. Obviously, reliability is still not maxed out, but in terms of pure performance of the car out on track, engine, chassis, and aero, that is all maxed out near enough. We've got one final little upgrade from Renault. Obviously, the engine supply in this year's game can give us upgrades, but that's scheduled for next season, it says. So we have to wait all the way till next season to receive that final little engine update from Renault. But what we can do, we've maxed out. So we pretty much can't go anywhere from here. So, as I said last episode, it's a great place to be. On paper, the best car on the grid, but it also means now, as we've seen, because the field is so, so tight, track to track, depending on the characteristics of the circuit, you're going to see some undulation from circuit to circuit, because it's not really the upgrades now determining how good people are, because we're all so close together. Like on the R&D chart, we're pretty much like overlapping Mercedes now, I think, or just above them. Ferrari and Red Bull, we know at the start of the season, they were overlapping each other. Same for McLaren, I think, also very close behind. Racing Point have also made some upgrades, it would seem, going into this one, I think, I know, looking at the R&D chart. So, you know, it's basically going to be a bit of a kind of unknown every single circuit, coming to each one and kind of seeing, okay, who's turning up in qualifying, and maybe that's going to tell us who's going to be good in the race. But, you know, if we turn up and we're not good in qualifying, there's not much we can exactly do to rectify that in that race and the next one or whatnot, because we've got no more upgrades to do. So this is it. It's kind of an exciting time to have a fully maxed out car, because remember, this is the My Team car. This is the best car I'm ever going to drive ever on this game in this career mode. No matter how many times, you know, this car maybe gets reset in the future and we build it back up, this will be the best car we drive that we've got right now going to Zandvoort. So it's exciting, but at the same time, it's also nervy, because knowing that we're pretty much hit this ceiling, basically, of development. But here we are then now going into the race weekend for Zandvoort for Saturday qualifying. Overcast conditions at the moment, and as I alluded to, it was a very tough time for us last season. And yes, it should be, in theory, a much better time for us this season. As a team, we should do better around Zandvoort now. The car is in a much better place than it was this time in Season 4. But the thing is, I have got to admit, I'm still not quick enough around Zandvoort. I've not got used to the circuit yet. It's still time I'm leaving on the table, especially in Sector 3 and also Sector 2. To be honest, Sector 1's all right. Sector 2, losing maybe about 5/10, I would say, in the last sector as well, a little bit, but not as much. I think Sector 2 is actually the main bit, to be honest. And I just don't know, you know, I need to just basically do more laps around this circuit, maybe do more laps in practice, but obviously with the nature of, you know, doing videos daily, I don't really have the time to just go out and hot lap circuits like that, to get used to it, basically. But, you know, it's been the case with other circuits. I remember Baku. I don't think I particularly liked Baku back in the day, but, and I wasn't particularly quick at it, but now I've got a lot better at it, and I'm quite quick around Azerbaijan. But Zandvoort, yeah, still getting used to it after 5 seasons, and I think, as you can plainly see there, there's a lot of time to be found on the table versus Pierre Gasly. So even though the car's better, I don't know, let's see how this goes into Q2, and we'll just see how it is in the race then. But I'm quietly kind of a little bit cautious about what we might be able to do in this race, but you never know, never say never. So we're in through to Q2 now, and the sun has come out here, around Zandvoort. So let's see if that's going to heat up the circuit any kind of way. Maybe heat things up for us maybe on this one lap flyer in anger across the line. And it is P3 there. But Gasly and Leclerc on the top left, you can see, have qualified and finished the session qualified on medium tyres. So they're going to try something a little bit different. I mean, the tyre wear levels are so low around here now with the upgrades every team has got. It's still going to be a one-stop, I imagine, from soft to hard, from medium to hard. So I don't know how much of an advantage that may be. They'll maybe find a little bit of time, potentially, towards the end of our stints when our soft tyres start to go off. Their mediums will still be in good condition. So a little bit of an advantage maybe our teammate and Leclerc has. So already, maybe those two are in a much better position strategically than we might be and everyone else. But yeah, I'm not going to get fussed about being close to Gasly there in that session because he's on one compound harder tyre. So, you know, it's now nowhere to hide in Q3. Everyone's going to have the soft tyre and I'm going to be wincing a little bit because I don't think we're going to be able to match him. I think, you know, we only matched him there because he was on medium. So I think he's going to gain a good 5 tenths here minimum. And unless everyone else is a lot slower, I think we might have difficulty being towards the front end where I think Gasly should be with a maxed out car. Let's see. We're here in Q3, the top 10 shooter across the line. And it's P5 at the moment behind Leclerc, Giovinazzi. And it's looking okay for us at the moment. We are a good 7.5 tenths behind our teammate who's on provisional pole position. So he's done a stonking job there in the same piece of machinery. But at the moment, position-wise, actually what I said has come true. A few people have not been too quick. The two McLarens tripped over themselves. Maybe Ricciardo looking a little bit slow there as well as Verstappen. So at the moment, actually pretty good there to be P5. But even if the time is massively kind of embarrassing in a way. But you see there, the five people below us going a little slower than they were in Q2. So that's good news for us. It can happen. Obviously, we've seen it a few times last season where we had a few bonkers Q3s where people have, for some reason, just not got the lap in. They've either hit traffic or, I don't know, they made a mistake on the lap or whatnot. I don't really know how the simulation times work, to be honest, with the AI fully in qualifying sessions. But, you know, we've had cases where people have gone slower and so we can, you know, benefit from that. But at the moment, we are going much slower than last time. That is a big mistake there on the left-hander as I got the tire on the left-hand side. I was hardly up anyway. I was like up by a thousandth, if that, by the time we got to the end of Sector 2 pretty much. And then I made a mistake. So that's my lap blown. And look at the top left. P9. That is frankly just not good enough. We've not done well there. Sector 1, we didn't gain enough time, if any. I think then any time we did gain in Sector 1, we lost in Sector 2, and then I blew it all going into Sector 3 with that tyre on the left-hand side curb, and so I just abandoned the lap because there was no point going on and even finishing it because it wouldn't have been any faster. And so we're down in P9 with the best car on the grid, quote-unquote, on paper, and Gasly is on pole position by 9 tenths to us and 2 tenths ahead of the nearest next car, Carlos Sainz in the Red Bull, who's done a very good job. I didn't think Red Bull would be that great around here. I thought the Ferraris, maybe McLarens would benefit a little bit from the kind of power you need to accelerate out of some of these long swooping corners. But obviously there is some aero obviously involved, so maybe not too surprising. But, you know, Sainz did a good job there in P2. Then Giovinazzi done well to out-qualify Leclerc. Norris done well to, again, outshine Ocon. Verstappen, I'm not too sure where the Mercedes is. Obviously, he did very well at Australia, but maybe that was a one-time kind of thing, and that's maybe where the Mercedes truly is. And obviously, now on the R&D chart, Mercedes are actually no longer the best car. We are the best car, so I don't know really where Mercedes stand. But for us, that's not good enough. We should have been at least, you know, splitting the two Ferraris, minimum, I feel, in terms of looking at the grid spread. So it's time to head to the grid on Sunday, and we've got a lot of making up to do, but I'm not too sure what kind of race we can have from B9, but let's just go for it.
Welcome along then to the North Sea coast and Zandvoort, 25 miles away from Amsterdam, and the host for today's Dutch Grand Prix. It's a race the great Jim Clark won on 4 occasions, leading for an astonishing total of 370 laps. 4 lefts and 10 rights make up the 14 corners of the narrow and demanding Zandvoort circuit, with plenty of peaks and valleys over the course of a 2.6 mile lap, which will demand absolute concentration from our drivers here today. Joining us today to oversee all the thrills and spills, it's Anthony Davidson. And great to see you. How are you feeling about the race today, and how are the circuit conditions from what you've seen?
Well, it's looking a bit cold out there, if I'm honest. These tyres have quite a narrow operating window in terms of the temperatures they need to extract the best grip. So with a cold track surface, it's going to be harder to keep those temperatures up, which will lead to lower grip and maybe more mistakes.
It's time to see how our drivers are stacking up after yesterday's exciting qualifying session. Pierre Gasly lines up on pole position, and talented Spaniard Carlos Sainz completes the front row. Considering the rest of the grid, we have Giovinazzi, Leclerc, Lando Norris, and Verstappen, Ricciardo, Ocon, the owner driver, and Lance Stroll, Hamilton, Kvyat, Alexander Albon, and Perez, Matsushita, Russell, Valtteri Bottas, and Nicholas Latifi, De Vries, Schumacher, Magnussen, and Jack Aitken. Which of these talented drivers will come out on top today?
So from a very disappointing Saturday, sat in P9, as I alluded to, the strategy is going to be a one-stop for us from soft tyres to hards, which is why, you know, even though Gasly, our teammate on pole, and Leclerc qualified on mediums, I don't know how much of an advantage that will be for them, apart from obviously, yeah, at the end of this stint, they'll be a little bit quicker on those mediums, but if they go to a set of hards, it doesn't really matter, really. So, and because of that, because everyone's maybe going to be on a one-stop, it's going to be difficult doing anything clever on the strategy, but we'll just go out there as per usual, give it all, and take solace in the fact that it can't get much worse than season 4, let's be real. So at least there's that, and the car in theory obviously does have the pace. It's on pole position in the hands of Pierre Gasly. Here we go then to round 3 of season 5 at the Dutch Grand Prix, and we're underway at Zandvoort, and it's a bit of a pedestrian start for us, I can't lie. Wanted to get off the line a little bit quicker there. We go around the outside though of the Red Bull and McLaren of Ocon and Ricciardo. They get boxed in behind Lando Norris and Verstappen, so we've made a pretty decent start actually from a slow getaway. Meanwhile, Giovinazzi has overtaken Gasly. The Ferrari is in the lead. The Italian leads the Dutch GP. Verstappen is very, very slow. We're practically pushing him up that hill, that corner on the left-hander, and we got held up so much by the Mercedes on that left-hander. Even Ricciardo was nearly bumping into the back of my gearbox there, so nose-to-tail stuff. But there is then the Ferrari. Giovinazzi leads the way from Pierre Gasly. Then you've got Leclerc and Sainz down in P4. So Sainz has had a stinker of a getaway, and he's lost 2 positions off the start from P2 down to P4. Meanwhile, for once, we're actually looking strong in this part of the circuit versus Verstappen as we get a good exit, good launch using a lot of ERS. Down the inside we go into the chicane, right and left. Verstappen gives us the room, but it's so tight to make 2 wide work through there. But somehow we managed it on our old teammate from season 3. And so we're up then into P6. So all things considered, I think that's a very good start from us actually, because it was a very slow getaway off the 5 red lights. Then we managed to actually get 2 moves done in turn 1 with everyone being boxed in, and I think we've done well there to pressurize Verstappen. And I was, as I said, surprised at my launch off that left-hander, that very same left-hander where I mucked it up in Q3 obviously on my second flyer. So good stuff there, learning from the mistakes on Saturday. Now we go on and chase after Lando Norris onto lap 3, gaining, but not quite enough. Obviously DRS enabled this lap. We have a little bit of a half-hearted look, and he locks up actually with a bit of a pressure there. So trying to pile on the pressure on our fellow Brit, but unable to make the move quite yet. But maybe with DRS now, we will be able to make a lunge as we, again, pressurise him, to be fair, again, in that left-hander. So, you know, keeping him on the toes, keeping the mirrors full of our car. But on lap 3, we have already massive tyre issues. Look at that front left tyre on the internal carcass temperature. It was brick orange on that left-hander. Through the chicane, it gets a little bit cooler. And then by the time we get to turn 1, it's, lime green to kind of back to kind of optimum temperature. But yeah, in sector 2, already on lap 3, the tyres are cooking. Lap 5, it continues again. And so we're in a bit of a world of pain of understeer, basically, every single time we get to the end of this lap. But at the same time, I've actually gone and set a personal best lap time, so we're kind of driving around it and kind of, you know, just dealing with it in the last sector and then trying to push as hard as we can in the first 2 to catch up to Norris. And you can see a bit of a squirm there as he enters that right hander down the crest before going through the left hander, and we sense maybe a move coming. He's a bit slow, the McLaren, so here we go, using all the ERS we can muster to the inside. It's gonna be so fine. Bit of contact even made there with our fellow Brit. We go wheel to wheel with Lando Norris through the right hander again. It's so fine, millimeter metres separating the left-hand side to his right. He's switchbacked us, so the fight continues on. It's a great ding-dong scrap here with the golf-liveried McLaren, but look at the front left the entire time screaming away for some respite from the temperature, but we managed to get it done as, again, on the left-hander, somehow we get a good launch, a launch we never got in qualifying ever on the flying laps, and we're able to finish that move off and get up into P5. Opportunistic, caught him a little bit weak in sector two. I think if we kept on waiting for the last sector, the banking, I think that McLaren is quick enough in a straight line for us to not be able to overtake him. But doing it in sector two, getting side by side with him, you know, jockeying for position, that's where we're able to really work our magic versus some of the AI, I guess, around a circuit like this and get the job done. So now, having overtaken Norris behind him, there's a bit of a gap in Verstappen. The man we dropped on lap one is holding up a train of Ricciardo, Ocon, and even the two Aston Martin cars as well in the background. So that's a very tasty fight, maybe for the last points paying positions. But we move on now towards lap number eight. And you can clearly see on the bottom right there on the heads up display, not only is my front left tire now screaming, my right front tire is also getting a bit hot and yellow on the internal carcass temperature. So the understeer is now getting to the point where I can't drive around it. I can't kind of deal with it. It's slowing me down now in the last two sectors. Sector one's the only place I'm going green, as you can see in the top right. So I'm actually going to call in to box in this lap on lap number nine, probably two, three laps earlier than my team wanted me to. And I have decided I am just throwing balls to the wall. I'm going aggressive and I'm going onto a set of medium tires, and we're going to do a two-stop this race, because I basically saw the situation of I was pulling away from Norris. I wasn't really catching the Red Bull or the Ferraris or my teammate, and I was going to be in no man's land. And so I'd rather have basically an entertaining race and fight some people with a two-stop than have a pretty bland one with a one-stop. So it is a little bit kind of just because I want to have some fun here with a two-stop. But also, genuinely, if we're in this situation, we may as well try. May as well try something different to do something. Because if we just do the one-stop, I'm not going to overtake anyone else. I'm just going to finish up in P5 today. So I may as well have just ended the entire race highlights by that point. So I thought, let's try something different. Let's go onto a two-stop and just push, push, push. Don't worry about the tire wear and just go for it. And we will be very rapid in this race right now, because at the moment, lap number 10, all the people out there right now are still on those worn softs going long for that one stop. All the mediums are hard. So here we are then, already closing up to some cars. We're in P14 to be fair. So we're actually not that far down the order, having made an early pit stop. And we go down the inside of the final corner there of Sergio Perez, or second last corner rather, as we go through the final bend now, the banking. And we close up now towards the Alpine car of, I think that's Danica Fiat, maybe up the road in towards turn one. Can we make the dive? No, not quite. A little bit far back, but as we go through the apex, Fiat's very slow. He pinches himself into the curb, and we go the long way around, toe-to-toe with the Russian, and just manage to squeeze him out there into the next right, and we're up into P12. And now, finally with some clean air on lap 11, onto 12, we set the fast lap of the Grand Prix. Purple there, as I said, we are for now going to be the fastest man on track for sure, because we're the earliest man in to the pits. And only now, lap number 12, are people starting to come in. Lap 11 as well before that first pit stop. Onto a set of hard tires we go, and set another purple, and we're up into P9 now. And we're closing up to Lewis Hamilton, who is yet to pit in this Grand Prix. He has started on the medium tires. We haven't seen him this entire race. I didn't see much of him the entire last race either at Bahrain. But here we are then, closing up to our other fellow Brit this Grand Prix. So it's a very British battle so far at the Dutch Grand Prix. Overtook Norris earlier. Now we go for the move on Lewis Hamilton across the line. Lap number 14 up into P5. So right now at the moment, we're effectively back to where we were. You know, we pit from P5. We're back in P5. But the difference is, look how close now Carlos Sainz is to us. Now remember, I do have one extra pit stop because he was on hard tyres. Giovinazzi up ahead of him is on hard tyres. These two started on the soft compound tyres. That's why they're already on these hards. Whereas Leclerc and Gasly are yet to pit still, going on those mediums they started on. But here we go for the move on Sainz. Sainz goes for the squeeze into turn one there, and it's close on the exit, but we're able to squeeze him out, open up the steering wheel. He doesn't put up a much of a fight, but he doesn't need to, because I guess his team have told him that I'm on a different strategy. I'm pitting again. So now, if I have any desire to make this two-stop work against these guys, I need to keep on going rapid time, and I need to basically build a pit stop gap now to Sainz, which I know sounds crazy considering I was 9/10 off pole position, But the thing is, the medium tyres are very good. They're very good race tyres. They are heating up, I must say. Look at the front left. It's still heating up in the last sector, even though these tyres are quite new, relatively new. But they are much better race tyres than the hards. And look at this. We're going to come out just behind Leclerc. But we go for the dive on the outside to the inside for the left-hander. Myself and Leclerc neck and neck. And we squeeze out the Ferrari man. And we just about get track position up into third place there. So we've got some clean air now to work with up to Giovinazzi. Speaking of, the Italian is actually in second place now. Pierre Gasly has managed to jump the Italian. So Gasly leads the way on a set of hard tyres. Giovinazzi in second place then. So the decision to go on medium tyres in Q2 on Saturday's worked out massively for Gasly then. He's in the lead, and we know how good he has been at controlling a lead, i.e. from last season Singapore, where he led pretty much every single lap of that great GP win. But now here for us, lap 16 onto 17, Leclerc has passed us, and actually I've only just noticed, look at the tyres he's on. Leclerc started on mediums, and he's pit onto a set of soft tyres. So we've been joined by the Ferrari man. We're not the only one here now in the top 10 doing a two-stop. So we've actually got some company here this afternoon. So we've got Gasly in the lead, Giovinazzi second, both on hard tyres. Leclerc, I don't know what, maybe just feeling very punchy. I don't know why exactly he's pit onto softs, because he could have easily pit onto hards and been still there with his teammate. But he's pit onto soft tyres, and on lap 18, he sets the fast lap of the Grand Prix. Surprise, surprise, being on the softest compound tyre, obviously with lower fuel now. But he's closing up to Giovinazzi, and also we are closing up to Giovinazzi, because Gio is very slow on those hards. He's two sets harder on the tyres than his teammates, so he's holding him up, and that's backing him up into us. And obviously we're still going at a decent pace on these medium tyres, even though we're not setting personal best lap times. So this is working out for not only us, but this will work out for Leclerc as well. And if we're clever about it, we could work as a kind of team with Leclerc unknowingly to him, and we can use him to drag us along in this two-stop, and this could actually work out very well for us, you know. So I'm glad we did the gamble and just said, you know, just screw it and went on to the two-stop. This has now become very interesting indeed. And as we cut on later into that lap, onto the next, through the banking, onto lap number 19, Leclerc with DRS. So we've got DRS as well, within 1 second of the two Ferraris, but Leclerc goes for the move the long way round. It's very close. Giovinazzi tries to fight it, but then he gets a tank slapper on the exit. Now we're there, and it's deja vu as we make the same move we made on Leclerc previously, around the outside of that very tricky right-hander that goes blind over the crest into the left. And we are up into P3, and we've already made about a 3.5 second gap to Sainz. So the pace is there to potentially build that gap for that extra pit stop we're going to have to make, obviously, in this Grand Prix. But the only issue is Leclerc is so quick on those soft compound tyres that he's pulling away. He's well ahead 1 second, so I don't have DRS anymore off him. So that was a kind of, you know, obviously consolation of being behind him as we get the DRS. So at the moment, it's a little bit tricky, but there is some traffic just up the road. You can see in the distance, so the traffic's going to help us a little bit to close back up to Leclerc. So even though he's still going quickly, the traffic will just give us a little bit of a buffer, a bit of breathing room to catch back up, get in that DRS, and there you go. He has to make the move on the inside. That was to De Vries in the Williams car. Obviously, remember, De Vries used to be in the Ferrari alongside Leclerc way back in, was it season 2 or season 3? So how times change. But you can see the other Williams now, the Aitken holds up Leclerc. So these back markers are doing us a world of wonder right now, just slowing Leclerc up enough that we're still within 1 second, but we're still, as a unit, as a duo, going quick enough that we're catching Gasly, we're bridging the gap, we're building a gap then also behind us to Giovinazzi and Carlos Sainz. And eventually, here we are then, we're met with the view of Leclerc right up the chuff of Pierre Gasly. Now Gasly leading the Grand Prix, but he's on a set of hard tyres, so Leclerc should have the pace to overtake him. But of course, Gasly does have some decent pace. He was the pole man, and our car is pretty good in a straight line. I think a little bit better than the Ferrari, at least. Maybe compared to some other cars, maybe not, but I think it just about has the Ferrari covered. So at the moment, we go back to our POV, lap 23 then, two personal best lap times on the first and second sector there, but up ahead of us, Leclerc still unable to make a move on gas. He's actually a little bit behind now. He's actually kind of backed off a little bit, so maybe his tyres now are going off, because remember, he's on softs. He pit on lap 15 or 16, was it? So around now, as we saw with our tyres, his soft compound tyres surely are going off now. But as we move through to lap 26, 10 laps to go in this Grand Prix, I'm thinking about going onto a set of soft tyres. I will admit I did consider going onto another set of mediums just because it was such a good race tyre, but I feel like we have to surely just go for it and go on the softs and just go for some Banzai laps, because I don't even know if we've got enough of a gap. It's going to be close, just under 15 seconds then to Giovinazzi and Sainz, so that may just be enough to make the pit stop and get out ahead of them. But we're going to come in and we're going to cover off Leclerc because there was some traffic up the road ahead of Gasly. So I was always going to come in because I thought, okay, let's come in, let's not hit that traffic, and let's try and get an undercut. To my annoyance, obviously, Leclerc has come in as well ahead of me. So both of us in. I'm onto a set of soft tyres though, and he's onto a set of mediums. And we actually came out in the middle of him. We actually ghosted through his car. So that was a bit unfortunate. But there we are. Look at that. Look at the work myself and Leclerc have done. We come out ahead of both Giovinazzi and Sainz. That is amazing. We have had so much pace in this race. Along with Leclerc, we've been the two fastest men on this circuit today, and we have done it. We've managed to pull off a two-stop against those two. Obviously, Gasly's still in the lead, but I don't think he was ever in the realm of my possibility of racing. But you never know now. We're on the soft compound attire. Leclerc is as well, because he's done a medium to soft strategy. So both of us on the softest compound attire, low fuel. Never say never. This race is still not over. We could catch Gasly. You never know. We've got that much pace. I wouldn't put it past us. So let's just carry on pushing and just keep on going and keep on chasing after Leclerc. And that's the thing. In this race, I was loving it in the middle of this stint, because Leclerc was so quick every single lap that he was really pushing me to keep up with him. And so I was just going and digging deeper and deeper, trying to find more and more time to keep up with him. So it was a really enjoyable race. Actually, I was very surprised how much I was enjoying this race compared to how bad qualifying was. But that's what happens when you kind of zone in on a target like Leclerc, who's so quick, and he just makes you push harder. And it hasn't been like a race long battle per se, because we've already been side by side for a brief moment when he exited the pit lane. But it's been a great race just where we pushed each other, and it's kind of felt like a battle. I guess a battle of the kind of stopwatches, basically. Every single lap just going quicker and quicker and trying to gain that extra time on these fresh tyres. But now we're both coming up to some more traffic here. The two Alfa Romeos of Russell and Latifi, I believe, are on lap 31. So five laps to go in this race. The gap is about 11 seconds more to Gasly. So if we're being real, I don't think we're going to catch him. So this is now a race between myself and Leclerc. He's been held up by Russell a little bit, and he gets held up by a lot by Latifi. He's very slow. Oh, he's so slow that we might even go for a move here. It's so fine. We're nearly three wide there. We had to let off a little bit because I was going to hit Latifi and or Leclerc there. But Latifi, the Canadian, slowed up, but probably the one of the worst places to slow up at this circuit to let someone by. And we got so, so close. That was so frustrating. Look at this slow-mo of how close this was. It was three abreast pretty much there, but it was so fine. I had to, you know, counter steer and go a little bit right to correct myself, because I was going to otherwise hit the Alfa Romeo car. But so, so close. That was it, maybe. That could have been possibly our last chance to do the move to get P2. Because like in stint 2, although Leclerc's pushed us to be faster ourselves, he's still got the overriding pace. I'm still not that great around Zandvoort enough to really catch up to him. And so he's got that 1 second gap where we're just about within the DRS. But we're only just about there by a thread, basically. So we're just continuing to push as hard as we can. As I said, Leclerc is just kind of being a good yardstick for us, a kind of target to aim for. And so we're digging deep, trying to gain anything we can, every single sector. There's some traffic coming up that may help us again. Let's see. Could it come through good for us again like it did with Latifi? No, this time, Mashita, what are you doing, man? The Japanese driver is so slow at the wrong moment for us. He brake checks us, essentially, because if I kept accelerating through that corner or kind of roll the car through, as I would have done usually, I would have hit the Alpine car. So absolute calamity there, and it happens again. So maybe we used up all our luck with the traffic earlier. To be fair, we did get very lucky with Latifi, and we did get lucky earlier in the Grand Prix with some traffic. So in a way, it kind of was Leclerc's turn to get a little bit lucky there. So I'll say kind of fair play to that, but we continue to push on. We're going on now towards the last lap of the Grand Prix. Schumacher there in the Haas does not hold up Leclerc. Surprise, surprise, in the kind of junior Ferrari team, I guess. Obviously, he's a junior Ferrari driver as we go around the outside, and we continue to have our head down, pushing onto the last lap of the Grand Prix. We're still within 1 second. You never know, we could still get this if there's some more traffic. Leclerc, slow up ahead. Oh my!
What on earth was that? Sergio Perez, I think that was, stricken in the middle of the road. And my life has flashed before my eyes. What on earth was that? How have we escaped that? In a blink of a second, Leclerc went slow into turn one. I don't know the reason why. And it's because Sergio Perez, I think retiring at this Grand Prix, goes very slow on the racing line. How on earth have I kept that out of the rear end of the AlphaTauri and also the wall? That is so close. Last minute flinch steering from me to go left and then somehow drift the car across the grass because we go left there, full lock left, then full lock right. We're now sideways a bit, drifting the car through opposite lock, controlling the car as it slides across the grass, double lock up then in towards turn one to catch it and slow it down, and somehow we still make the apex. That is actually quite beautiful. That's actually quite nice driving with me, if I do say so myself, but what on earth was that? I'm looking at this replay again. That is insane. I've never seen an AI be that kind of stupid with how they're retiring out of a Grand Prix. And obviously, I saw yellow flags, but I didn't know what the incident was. And then I saw the Ferrari in the red car, obviously more visible ahead of me, slowing down for some reason on the right-hand side, pulling out of the racing line. And then by the time we got so close to the AlphaTauri, it's pretty much either I crash into him, crash into Leclerc, or go left of him onto the grass. And so we picked the best option just out of flinch reaction, but oh my god, count our lucky stars that we've actually managed to survive that somehow. And so that is pretty much going to cap off what has been such an exciting Grand Prix. Honestly, maybe one of the most entertaining and intense races I've had on this game so far. But Pierre Gasly comes through to win the Dutch Grand Prix. His second win of his entire career in this career mode universe of ours, and also the Arab Archer Racing team. And we kind of limp home a bit shaken in P3 because what a last lap that was, coming onto it, avoiding what was a DNF kind of sort of crash and collision. And we come home for a podium from P9 with a stonking effort for a two-stop along with Leclerc, to be fair. So GG's to him as well.
A nearly flawless performance here then, and a commanding victory. Tell me, Ant, how do you think they were able to deliver such an incredible result today?
I feel like consistency was probably the key today. There's being quick, and then there's being quick lap after lap after lap. If you can do that, you can capitalise on other people's errors without making many of your own. And that's an approach that can push you a long way up the field.
Welcome then to the podium, our top three drivers. What a great effort from them today in a very difficult race.
So there you have it, Pierre Gasly is a winner once again in our car. That means he's, since he's joined the team, he's had two wins and I've had zero. I'm still winless from last season to this one. Obviously, this was a bit of a different race. I don't think I was ever going to win this race, so I'm not really annoyed at that. But obviously, it is, it's a really weird situation to be. I don't think I've actually ever been in a situation like this where my teammate is actually thoroughly got me kind of covered off. You know, he is, you know, arguably the number one driver right now in the team. He's the one getting the win. He's the one with two wins from last season to this one. And he's the one that leads the championship. So, you know, going into this one, into this season, I mean, I thought, you know, it's going to be interesting to see what the battle's like. You know, will we be battling, you know, the Red Bull, the Ferrari, you know, McLaren? And I was wondering how much of a challenge Gasly's going to be. Well, so far, he's been pretty damn consistent as I have, really. And so that's why he's in the championship right now. So we've got work to do. We're 10 points back. We know we've got a race-winning car now this season, you know, obviously, as he's just won the race. But obviously, I thought from last race even, we had a very strong car. We got a strong package. It's just about now, we need to break this duck. We need to break this kind of bogey cycle now of being without a win since all the way to season 3 at the Singapore Grand Prix. That's how long it's been since our last win in F1 on this game in my team career mode. So we need to try and break that duck sooner rather than later, to be honest. Otherwise, it may come back to haunt us. But what a mental race. Let's go back to that. That was insane. That entire race for the two-stop working out for us, the way me and Leclerc pushed each other was great. Let alone then that last lap of hysteria where Sergio Perez nearly effectively took me out because I didn't see what on earth he was doing. I thought he was just a lapped car that Leclerc was pulling to the inside to overtake. And then by the time I got there, it was just basically flinch reaction to avoid that.
that. Bonkers stuff. And I think that makes that maybe one of the most exciting races and intense ones, like I said, I've had on the game so far, which is just great, because Season 5, it just keeps on getting better and better with this game. It really, really is quite enjoyable. So, guys, if you did enjoy that one, smash the like button. Let me know what you thought in the comments below. If you're already around here, then do get subscribed for weekly Formula 1 content. I've been Arava, and I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye.